to have here Bubul and JFS, who will tell us about a bit about the results of that ad hoc sessions, about the current state of internationalization and language things. Welcome.
Sorry, the other beamer is not working. That one there.
Hola a todos. Nos alegra veros aquí. Bienvenidos a la charla de internacionalización. My chance for you, the remaining of this talk would be in English. Part could be in Spanish, yes. So the main point of the talk is doing a kind of state of the art of internationalization, quite arrogant statement, state of the art. Well, the main point is to say here what you are with internationalization in Debian, and here is what we want to go. We will talk about this at the end. We are very productive both sessions currently during DebConf. And I think the summary I'll give you at the end of this talk will be interesting to give good ideas for the future. So, basically we will have a kind of introductory part about internationalization again a talk about internationalization. We will talk about the project in Debian, we will talk about the infrastructure of internationalization, which would be the point also of the summary. We'll talk about the tools we use for internationalization in Debian, the relationship with other projects upstream or other free software projects, a conclusion as usual, and after a conclusion, which will not be exactly a conclusion, we will have a kind of summary of what has been done as work for internationalization infrastructure work. I'll explain you at the end. So, internationalization again. So first, my favorite statement, which I did last year in Helsinki, and I'm afraid it's still true, English still sucks. Okay, how many English native speakers are in the audience? Okay, and how many non-native English speakers are idiots? Okay, we won, guys, so English sucks. Yeah, but this is our de facto communication language, you know. It covers only 5 to 15% of the world population, so we have to cover all the remaining population if we want more users. Operating system not only in English, of course, is not a universal operating system. Or you know that Debian is the universal operating system, of course. And even not all geeks speak English. This is a very common idée reçue, I would say in French. You know, all geeks speak English. I don't care about English. My own system, I'm not a geek, but anyway, my own system speaks French, okay? Javier's system speaks Spanish. He does. Okay, so let's go. I had to put this one somewhere. So let's go toward world domination, the path toward domination. You know about this one, you know, but I like it. So in Potato, we had one language covers this. This is about the installer. And now we have this. Yes, that's good. And as I like it, and I hopefully you like it. Thank you. So we'll do it again. The last part of South America is Guyana, which official language and most spoken language is neither Dutch nor English. I don't know which one it is. So let's do it again for the sake of it. I'd like to, if you have questions, I'd like to keep them for the end, please. Yeah, just for the sake of it and slowly, in Sarge. This is what we were last year, mostly. In the recent release of DI, we were 53 languages, and now we are, das ist gut. that is good. 63 languages are currently supported in DI, so we can say that from the beginning, Debian supports 63 languages. And as you see, we begin supporting more parts of Asia. Yes, that is good still. So why did this happen? This mostly happened because the wars between maintainers and translators are mostly over. Those of you who were in Debian several years ago remember of these fights and flame wars and so all these nasty things. This is completely over. And internationalization, which was kind of last wheel of the car, is now becoming one of the most important parts of Debian, for me, of course, but for many people in the project. And more importantly, I think it's closer to the heart of nearly all development issues.
Okay, so translation wars are over, but there are still skirmishes. Actually in the paper, there's a lot of information there, so you got all that in the procedure, so we're not gonna go in detail in every step, but we wanted to focus the translations on some things that are good for maintainers more than translators, because we already have all our buffs and all our talks, cabal talks. So one of the main points we wanna make here in the talk is that translations are actually very good for code you write or packages you provide to users, because that actually makes that code more available to users, because that more people are going to use that because it's available in their languages. So you have to treat translators, and that's actually one of the things that the project has changed and shifted to, because you can now go into the new maintainer process as a translator, so you don't know anything about code, you just do translation and you can get into the project with those testing skills. So translators should be treated as valuable contributors. That's one of the reasons why projects that actually give CVS or SVN or whatever access to their translators actually get a very much better translation than those that don't, okay? So some helpful advice here is that actually translations helps improve the quality of the things you write, because they actually review stuff. So, for example, on the Spanish mailing list, the guy that was translating a manual I wrote, the Securing Debian manual, actually pointed in the mailing list that in which I'm subscribed about something that didn't make sense on the document, and I actually said, yeah, it doesn't make any sense here, because he was actually translating it, and he was trying to see how to make the translation, and actually that made that part of the document improve, because I noticed that the translation had issues with that, and that actually happens a lot. So translations are a way to do quality assurance of the documentation and the messages you rewrite. They actually find typos on those messages, and they actually tell you this is not consistent with what other parts of the project is. Okay, so that's actually one of the reasons you might want to do translations. But in order to do them, you have to help translations get translations done. That means let them have time to do translations. So that's why you have to make swing freezes and say, okay, I'm not gonna change anything from now on. I'm not gonna do a new release every day. Messages are not gonna change. You can now translate all the things we have here. Because otherwise, translators, if you don't do this, will get pissed and will abandon your project because you're making change every and every day, okay? And actually, translators are aware of some sources you can use for translation. I mean, some things that can be translated in Debian, which is probably not all of it. And that's why maintainers that know what pieces of code can be translated in their packages should go to Debian i18n mailing list and say, okay, I want this translated. Could you please translate that for me? Or I want this updated. Could you please update it for me? So that actually is something that maintainers could do in order to improve the translation process. So we're gonna go now into some projects. I'm gonna talk about a few. Christian is gonna talk about another one. We're not going to go into details. You have the details in the paper. We're just gonna give you an overview of those. Okay, so the website is probably one of the things that is best translated in Debian. We have a number of teams working that. We're actually working both with content negotiation on the client on the server side, so all mirrors use content negotiation. User doesn't have to go to the website and select the language they want the website to see in. That's supposed to be done on the client side. So if the user is working with a Spanish-speaking system he installed, he's gonna see the website in Spanish, which actually seems like a no-brainer, But you can go over and check out some other free software projects and see how many of them you have to go and say, I want that in Spanish, I want that in Russian, I want that in Japanese, okay? And we manage that stuff with both translation headers, we'll probably talk about that later, and with the GetX. It's actually translated, well, there's teams working on 33 different languages, but only 6 of them have most of the content translated, depending if you take into account number of pages or number of bytes, okay? We also have a lot of documentation translated. That means actually translators have access to this Debian documentation project if they ask for it, and they can work on that translation there, or they can use, you know, the maintainer of the document as a proxy. And there's actually some documentation there, and there's some documentation out of it. So like the Debian installer manual is outside that project, but the translator have access to that. And even though we're not all the way there, and you'll see that, we're starting to use tools that try to help translators to get their work done, both on the, you know, the first, to see what is translated and what is not, and when the documentation people make changes to see what has changed and what's not. The man pages is kind of an issue because we write man pages for programs we write on Debian, and we also provide man pages for packages we provide outside Debian. That's kind of a mess because there's both man pages inside some packages, and there's also these man pages /es/fr/d whatever that provide man pages for some comments that are not on those packages. So it gets translated, but it's not that easy to handle. We don't currently do any work, and actually I don't believe any project is doing that, the translation on the info documentation. Okay, so that's a gap we have.
No, it's still your part.
So we can do this dance more time. just to give an overall stats, you guys get an impression, the release notice now from the last release has been translated to 11 different languages. That has been increasing with each release. And there's more than 20 teams working on the Debian documentation project, although not all of them are as active. And the manual, the Debian installation manual, is actually translated to 15 different languages. I think that's probably few free software operating system projects can boast about that. Most have maybe 3, 4, at most 5 translations of their main documentation. They might have more coverage of documentation, you know, like Red Hat, the documentation might cover, they both have translated the installation manual, the system guide, the what, because they pay professional translators to do that. But they don't have as many languages. And if you take a look at what Mandrake or SUSE or OpenBSD or FreeBSD has translated, they don't have that much coverage. So it's actually something we can be very proud of, just like with the installer.
So that is yours, yes. We want the much more Tango. Yeah, we will. Yeah, package descriptions are part of packages, of course. You all know about this project, which was named the DDTP, Debian Description Translation Project. This is a big demand by our users, because our users are actually installing packages. They are looking for software for doing this or that. So what should I install for doing this or that? And what is this software I've seen on my system, and what is it doing on my system? So this is currently work in progress. We'll talk about at the end. The current status of translation are available at the address you see on the slide. I won't repeat, I suck at giving URLs in English, so I won't try. The issues with, currently issues with package description, sorry. The project has been abandoned for a while after the compromise of the Debian machines, and it has recently been renewed slightly. It needed APT changes, which have been done recently and which are in 0.6 version of APT. Other issues are the work done in Ubuntu currently. Ubuntu is working on Debian package description translation, sorry, most often Debian package. We don't know much about it, so we don't know how it's happening and what's happening about it. Anyway, the next step will probably be some action collaboration with the FTP masters to have these package description translation put on the FTP servers along with the packages files and available to download by the new EPT. Another big important part of localization of packages are the DebConf screens translation, DebConf templates translation. So in that part, we have the killer application named Prio DebConf, written by Denis Barbier. So we have the magic tool for doing everything. We have the correct infrastructure. I will talk about it later. So this is one of the best translated parts in Debian currently. What we need now is probably more writing style consistency all over these Debian DebConf templates. You know about these things which are prompting you for passwords. Sometimes you have, please enter a password, or password colon, or password interrogation mark, and so on and so on. This is not consistent. This is not really professional style, I would say. And we have to have some overall consistency. This is explained in the section 6.5 in the developer's reference. Now, and now your maintainers should a bit listen about with to Lintian, actually, because recently a lot of warnings have been added to Lintian. So you maintainers who recompile your package with DebConf templates, look at the output of the Lintian, please. And you will be surprised. And you'll have the people to blame if you don't like it, but look at it. What's important here, again, is communication with translators. We will ask you all the time to your maintainer, package maintainer, communicate with translation. Here, we have, translators, we even have the right tool. This PO, DebConf report PO tool, is the right tool to communicate with translator. You want translation updates, you just launch this utility. Look at the man page, it's very well written. And no, it's not me who wrote it. So this is why it's well written, actually. We need you maintainers to provide up-to-date port files. This is very important for the localization infrastructure. This is very important. And we have recently discovered that many, many packages are provided without up-to-date port files, which means the DebConf templates do not correspond to what's provided to translators. So we believe we are okay, we are 100%, we are proud. And no, we are not complete. So one of the ways to provide this has been to suggest maintainers to use the DebConf update PO in the clean target of package. This is a quite debatable issue because this modifies the content of the build tree of the packages. But this is the best suggestion we have currently. Now, we covered mostly all of the various internationalization and localization projects in Debian. We'll see which infrastructure we currently have to deal with all this stuff, various stuff that you've seen, website, all these things. So we'll cover the PO translation statistics, which means we will talk about PO DebConf and programs translation. We'll cover the installer translation statistics, which is the more specific part. The use of the BTS, because this is the interaction between the maintainers and the translator. This is the best method of communication. And we'll talk about what we call the translation robots. Well, the PO DebConf and PO statistic web pages, I should call it the earlier framework for localization. Why framework? Because it gives statistics. So it can you make you proud, you translator, because your language is the first ranked at the top. Not you, actually, me, because this is French, which is ranked at top. But the most important, it gives access to the translation material. So it's pretty crude, but it actually works quite well. One thing important, which was recently added a few months ago, is it uses Popcorn statistics. So it ranks the most used packages first. So actually, translators have their tasks prioritized. This will be an important point in a future infrastructure because there is so much work that we need to prioritize tasks. We want to translate the Xorg templates before that obscure MySQL stuff, which is prompting me for so much things I don't know about. Okay. There are a few weaknesses in that process. Mostly, this framework depends on a few developers' account. It runs on the Gluck server, and it depends on Pierre Machard and Denis Barbier for the story. But this is some weakness because this is not completely integrated in our infrastructure. It works since about 3 or 4 years, so it can continue working. It only reflects the status of uploaded package. So this is a biggest weakness. More and more developers work with source control management systems and make their changes and change the wording of their templates or the wording of their programs. And they upload the changes. And we discover the changing after the upload. So we always desynchronize with the developers. And also, in the recent release, we were allowed, as translators or maintainers were allowed, to make translation updates during the freeze. So it would have been good to have status for testing, just to know which packages would benefit from translation updates. We have nothing for doing that, and we are in need of such a tool. The installer translation statistics, it's kind of attempt to override such of these limitations. It's possible because the installer is a project by itself. It's been coordinated quite strongly, I would say. So we have basically all what's needed to do some good framework. We have an all-in-one page. Most of the translators of the installer know about it. This all-in-one page, it's pretty huge, it's very long page, not the best page ever, but it gives the information. We have, moreover, the direct access to the material. It means we can grab the files from the installer SVN. As soon as Franz has the ID to change one minor string, first he gets me mad because I don't want him to do so, but then we discuss, we change it, and then the status pages are updated immediately, and the translators have access to it immediately. And this gives a great reactivity, and translators are happy, actually, because it gives them the opportunity to update strings one by one and not big bunch of changes. So we have this, I was on the strengths part anyway. We have a lot of weaknesses also in that process also. It depends on Zepi. Who is Zepi? What is Zepi? Zepi is Dennis Stampfer, who is running these status pages. So it depends on him to do some magic stuff on his account, on Gluck, on the Debian server, for the statistics to properly work. And this is kind of a weakness. It's also very sensitive to upstream changes. Because in the installer, we don't only have the core installer. We also included a few key packages which are seen by the installer, such as apt, such as dpackage, such as ISO codes, and so on and so on. So if the upstream, most often the Debian maintainer, changes SCM, SVN is completely out, so let's switch to bizar and OCR. We have to change everything. Not very scalable. And it needs actually someone who coordinates all the stuff and still survey the old stuff and also survey the old translators and comes with a bat. And we have to release, please update your translations. Anyway, I think we will always need such coordinators. There are also some strengths. I mentioned the reactivity. And another side effect, interesting side effect, in the recent years, it promoted what I call localization helper. Localization helper are people who are working with maintainers, but are mostly translators or translation specialists, and they help the maintainers to maintain their localization stuff. Oh, okay, Mr. Maintainer, oh, I want to make change to the, this string, but this doesn't affect translation. I don't want to make the translators mad. How should I do? And Mr. Localization Adapter, okay, I'll save you, my friend, and no one will hate you. Okay, this concept of localization helper is important. It makes a very small team of two people, and it works pretty well. Well, most of the time, I am the localization helper of many packages, but I hope that many others will show up soon. Another part of the framework is the BTS. The BTS in Debian is the way to communicate between people, between maintainers and translators. I said maintainers and translators have to talk together. So the first way to talk together is to use the BTS, of course. We promote the sending bug reports for translation updates. This is the easiest way, after all. We have a kind of standardized way to do so. Severity wish list. This is kind of historical way, which should be serious, in my opinion. The tags are l10n and patch, because you send a patch, you send a translation, you send a patch. The maintainers know how to apply it. The subject is somewhat codified. This is not really important. It helps most of the maintainers to know which language this is about. Because if I send you a file named dz.po, what the hell is that language? Who knows? DZ? Yeah. France knows, but no. This is Dzongkha. Dzongkha, language of Bhutan. Okay. I'm in my Bhutan mode currently. The material for translation should be, of course, attached to the bug reports. This is a message to translators. Don't forget the attachments. Okay, so use report bug. It will help you not forget it. Optionally compressed. Many translation teams like to send their updates compressed. This has been initiated by the Japanese people because they don't like us to mess up with their encodings, and we should not. So it's a good idea to send the files compressed with GZ. Currently not really often useful, but anyway, it's quite safe. So do it, do it.
Can I ask you a question there?
Because I repeat it.
In Norwegian we tend to like to send in clear text because you don't need to have all these extra tools, and you never know what kind of tools people use. So it's a point not packing text, but I can see the Japanese argument because it's not very supported on a web browser, for instance, but a lot of translators really likes things in clear text.
Yeah, the point is that really needed after all to compress the stuff? Yeah, the main, most important is not breaking anything. So, yeah, most often Latin languages translators do not send their translation compressed. I never do it. But it doesn't hurt after all, and it's safer. Now the mail user agents are safe, so that's not so much risk, but it's kind of tradition. In that regard, the maintainer duties, Javier also already talked about this. Please be responsive to these bug reports. This is a very easy to fix, even though if you don't have a localization helpers, it's just put the PO file in the right place. Check if it works, because sometimes it's broken. So you'd better look in our paper, there are ways to check profiles. Apply as soon as possible, yeah. Do translation updates during freezes. It's allowed. You can do it, so please do it. We will soon have a freeze, you know? So I want to be 100% for Edge, please. No, not 70%, Javier. That's yours, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so also important part of the infrastructure, and so you, or the people that are not involved in the translation process, actually, this might help them to you guys to see how work is actually done. Because some people just think that it's okay. I'll send a file to somebody, it gets translated, I receive it. You know, it's like professional services for free or whatever. Actually, many translation teams use, and that's not all of them currently, those that have a mailing list, use through the mailing list what we call a translation robot. And that's in part of the infrastructure because that's used for coordination of the translation. Basically, I'll probably show it better with this slide. Let's change to that one. Yeah, I'm going to do what you're not supposed to do in a talk. But it should work. Okay, it actually works. It works there. Good, you guys come over here. That's fun. And I put that in sleep mode, so we'll go back. Yeah. I'm going back. I'm not going to show it. Oh, that one fell. Okay, basically, what you have there is that you have teams making a process in order to ensure that the translation has a good enough quality. Okay? No, put it back there. No, don't worry about it. Thank you. 100% guy. What you can do, what the translation teams do is try to ensure the quality of the process by doing reviews of translations. So what we do is first, when translation wants to work on things, it says, okay, I'm gonna work on that to avoid duplication of stuff. So it will tell the other members of the team, I'm working on this, I'm gonna work on that, and I'm working on this. So those are the first two. That's a translation affair, right, Christian? I did that correctly? Okay, and the other one is intent to translate. So when a translator wants to work on something, he says, okay, we have to do this translation. That's probably the coordinator saying, you have to do that. And then the translation says, okay, I'm gonna do that one, okay? So if I'm gonna do that, please give me that one. Thank you. If I'm gonna do the intent to translate, then as soon as I finish, I'll go and ask for reviewers, okay? And I send that to the team, and that's just like when you do CVS comments to source code. If you send that and nobody answers, then you get, okay, did actually somebody review this? I'm not sure if my translation is good, please review that. And this is actually sent to the mailing list, so everybody can, you know, jump in and say, you didn't do this well, that should be done some other way, this is the proper translation for that term, and so on and so on and so. And when that is finished, then the translator will send a last call for comments and say, okay, this is the final file, are you all guys okay with that? And when that is done, it will be sent to the BTS. Eventually, at some point in time, it will be fixed by the maintainer, and then it will be done. Actually, no, because this is a loop again. So when the translation is updated by the maintainer, you get a loop here. Okay, so from here done again to intent to translate and whatever. That process that is made by most of the teams is actually automated by a robot that listens to the mailing list on all these pseudo URLs. So he knows what currently translation status is. So that main coordinator can say, okay, a guy sent a file he was going to translate. He hasn't been sent the translation for maybe 3 months. I'm going to ask another people to go back here and do it because he's obviously not responsive. Okay, so that actually is a process that is being used by many teams. Okay, so we're going to talk about some tools in Debian. Actually, I'm going to talk about two, and Christian about two, so we can, are fair enough here, there, that are used by both translators and maintainers. Yeah, go back. Yeah, that's okay. So one of the issues we have here is how to handle documentation translation, because it's not that recently that we've been using POR files for the documentation, okay? And that's really crappy, because I know that because my translators of the Securing Debian manual get very angry with me because when I make a change of a manual that I think is maybe 300 pages long, if you compile it into PDF format, if I make the change, it's really complicated to see where the change is, okay? So the translation teams, together with some other guys, have introduced a few files, few tools to work that, which is based on the same idea that the website works with. Okay, we're not going to introduce the tools that the website uses, but we're going to introduce these ones because we want you guys to use that. And it's called DocCheck. DocCheck is actually a script that is been that is different from some documentation that will work with translation headers on files, and it will tell the translators, okay, this file has been updated upstream, you have to review it and check the translation. And when that's inserted into a source code management system, he can actually know that he worked with revision 1.5, and the latest revision is 1.7, so he actually has to just ask for that diff, and he will just has to translate that diff, and not review the whole file with maybe 1,000 lines long. Actually, some of mine are. That's possible in some cases. When translation documentation is in XML format, we tend to just using PO XML, which will take the XML code and convert that to a PO file. That PO files, and if you don't, you have the paper for that, can do that management automatically. Okay, so instead of breaking on strings, that breaks on paragraphs, and that puts on a PO file so that the translator can just check the paragraph that changed. What's the issue of this? Actually, it's only used right now by 4 documents, but maybe 4 of the documents that are most translated, because the translators ask for that. And the different scripts and different header formats, so that needs to be unified. But one of the documents that uses that and has been really successful has been the Debian installer, okay? This is one of the reasons that it translated so many languages, because it's broken into many files, so there are not very big files, so translators can, actually see a change that's been made. They don't have to parse a very long diff. They can go to a very small diff. Next. Another tool, more user-oriented, that has been developed by translation teams, and actually not only translation teams, is both the use of localization config that has been used on Debian installer in Sarge, but it's no longer working for Edge. So if anybody wants to hop there, reintegrate it back, you're welcome to do that. Is that a tool that will actually handle the fuss of having all the different bits of the system that need to be localized? Because in some occasions, it's not just sufficient to just say locale is equals whatever. In my case, ES_ES. Maybe that's not sufficient. Maybe I have to touch IMEX in order to work with Latin 1 characters or UTF-8 characters or whatever. So I have to touch some files over there. Maybe I want to touch iSpell, so it will use by default when it installs this Spanish dictionary. It doesn't ask me, because I don't want him to ask me, because I already told the system that I'm going to work in a Spanish system. So that's the work of the localization config thing. And it will actually do some pre-seeding on DEFCON stuff. It will actually touch some files here and there, not many, but usually through pre-seeding when it's possible. And it will get the system localized as much as possible for users that say on the installation process, okay, I want this language. And I want this language all the way through, okay? Which is quite an improvement from Sarge, from Woody to Sarge, okay? I didn't do it. There was a member of the Greek team. I couldn't pronounce his name. Right now, he's in military service, so that's why he cannot work on this stuff right now. Okay, so that's what it does. Actually, there's another piece of that, which is Taxel, and that's thanks to Joey Hess doing that, which is that there are some tasks that are language-oriented tasks that will install a set of packages that are thought to be more useful for some guys. So when that actually works both in Woody and Edge. So this part is not broken, at least not yet. So that means that if a guy says, okay, I want in Spanish, so it will actually automatically install the Spanish task or the French task. We'll try to get his desktop kind of translated into Spanish, okay? That's yours.
So this is my advertisement moment. Again, you had it last year, those of you who were at Helsinki, you will have it again for PO4A. PO4A, PO for anything. This is a kind of an attempt to bring GetX translation, PO-based translation, to new files. Most of the time, text-based files. Text-based files like man pages or documentation or whatever. Actually, the most important part are the last dots. Barely this PO for anything. In Debian, this is a project that started like 2 or 3 years ago. It's currently quite widely used for man pages, for native packages. We are lucky enough to have in Debian the PO4A maintainer upstream maintainer. Please stand up, Nicola. Thank you. And the French, yeah, he stood up, yeah. And this initiated a lot of work inside the French team to bring more localization possibilities to the Debian native packages man pages, this long and boring dpackage apt or whatever package man pages. We have set up some experimental status pages for these man pages. We have the link in the slides. I'll show you at the end if you want. And the main problem is documentation. The big documentation currently prefers PoXML for big files. There are reasons for that. And this is often a debate between translators and maintainers, which is easily solved most of the time. So what we want to ask currently to maintainers is use it in your package, please. Try to have a look at PO4A, ask for help. The Debian internationalization mailing list is the good way to do so, and enjoy PO4A because PO4A can make your life way easier. So in short, of course, I said it a lot of time, PO4A rocks, thanks. PO-DebConf tools are very well-known tools because I said PO-DebConf is the oldest stuff, which is a good localization framework in Debian. We have a few tools. I'll cover it quite quickly. PO-DebConf update PO, I mentioned it. It's the way to have all the PO files, all the POT files related to DebConf templates up to date. So they have to be up to date. It should be run in the clean target, possibly. PO2DebConf is part of the package. Actually, it's mostly run automatically by DH install DebConf. So please use DebHelper. Don't use this funky YADA stuff that some people use. Right. PO2DebConf report PO, I mentioned it. This is the way of communication from the maintainer to the translator. The BTS is the way of communication from the translator to the maintainer, but we want the communication to go this way also. PO-DebConf report PO has been originally aimed for PO-DebConf translation. Actually, you can use it also for upstream translation. Just look at the man page. And it's aimed to warn translator for needed updates. It just sends mails. The relationship with other projects, I'll give the mic to Javier, but it's all about how to interact with other projects upstream or to package specific translation stuff for Debian.
Okay, thanks. I'm not going to go in detail about some projects. Let's go here first. Christian, you'll go too fast. We have plenty of time, right? Even though we started late. Okay, I'm not going to go into detail about projects that already do translations like the free software foundation or the genome or KDA project, because those are actually very easy to explain because we actually just reuse the translations. There's actually a very cross, pollination or between teams on one side of the sea on the other one. So actually the KDA teams and the genome teams share glossaries and they share it with us. So there's a lot of work between all the teams in order to do stuff. But what I'm going to talk about is one of the XX packages, which is not porn. Okay, so that XX stands for whatever, you know, language code is being used, which is are actually packages that maintainers will provide to and that actually will get installed by all the textual stuff I talked about. Mostly as independent package in the system, breaking down, you know, program and translations. Okay, so there's the good, the bad, and the ugly about these guys. If we all were porn, it will probably not be, well, probably we also have both of them. But in any case, the good thing is that it separates translations, users that want to install the translation of French but don't want Spanish, can do that because they're separated, so they don't use up the space. We don't have to use those hacks like the, what's called the one that breaks the, removes the translation?
Locale?
Local purge, yeah. That's kind of a hack in order to say, okay, I installed all this stuff, and now I remove it under your feet because you don't really want it. And I say, okay, all these profiles of languages you're not gonna use, I'm gonna remove them after installation of the package, but I actually don't load them, okay? So that's actually a very big waste of bandwidth for large profiles. So in order to avoid that, if the translation is separated, users can just download the translation they want to, so that's good. The problem is that when that translation is not integrated with the main source and is done independently, that means that it might not be on the same level as the original source. And that actually happens a lot with man pages, okay? Because man pages translations are developed not by us, not by the translation team within Debian, but by other guys, and they might not follow the man pages stuff that is done on CurlTools or FileTools, which are actually the man pages package that is distributed by the documentation, the Linux documentation project that provides that package. They actually follow a given version, but not by might not be the latest version, and it's not integrated. So it's not easy to check if the version distributed by them is the same version as the one that is being provided by the Linux documentation project, which ends being a problem, which is the ugly side. That is, the users, that user locale, are, might not be reading the latest up-to-date information of a man page, and they actually might be reading completely wrong information about a program, okay? There's also a problem because they don't notice, because man actually doesn't have any feature, like just like info I mentioned, doesn't have any feature to, it does have a feature to localize content, but it doesn't have any feature to show you if the content is up-to-date with the version, okay? So it doesn't do any versioning between them. And it, there's a lot of dependency problems that come around and hit us in the head when, for example, it happened to me with the Mozilla packages, when the translation is so tied with a given version that it only works with, 0.9 version of Mozilla. And when we upload that to SIP, that all goes well, they all proceed to testing fine, and testing has Mozilla 0.9, both French, Spanish, whatever. But when Mozilla 1.0 comes out and one of the translations are not updated, the package translations, that means that Mozilla cannot 1.0, that cannot go into testing because it will break package already existing in testing, because it will remove the Mozilla 0.9 package, but there's already a package that is the Spanish guy, for example me, that depends on that. So it will try to remove that, enter testing, it will break another package, so it will not go into testing, okay, because of a translation. It's actually even uglier than that, because man pages at some point in time are even moved on to upstream and including the source, and that means that when a new shadow version comes in that has the French translation, it has to be removed from man page FR, and at the same time a conflict version has to be introduced on shadow and on man page, so because they cannot be installed at the same time because they provide the same file. So crap, ugly. So it doesn't tie that much with the other one, but it's another issue when working with upstream. That is, one, it happens a lot of times. Well, it doesn't happen a lot of times. It happened to me at least a few times. When providing translations, you can actually decide to work either with the Debian version of the package or upstream version. If you work with the Debian version, you could work with that and send that to the BTS. What should the maintainer do when he receives that bug report of a version when he knows that a new one is available and he's going to package that? He could either, just let it die in the backtracking system. He could apply it on his version, make a release, and try to forward the port to the new version. Or what we actually suggest is he could tell a translator, you shouldn't be working with the versions we distribute because we don't want to diverge that much from a stream. And if you don't want to handle this translation, as a team, please go directly upstream. And that's actually the best case. So if you're as a maintainer, receive a bug of a given, a new translation, not a bug of an existing translation, which actually should go as in also, but in any case, you can decide if you want to integrate that or forward that upstream. And it's actually best if you forward not the file, but the translator upstream. So it's not a CC. You cannot you don't have a key for that on your MUA to forward the guy, but you have to forward the guy, not the file. So you can mark them as pending. You can close them with a new upstream release that includes that translations and handle them that way. There's a special corner case here, however, and those are the freezes. Because if you get translations updates during the freeze, you know you're not going to update a new version, and you know you cannot send the guy upstream. Even we're talking here about Debian freezes, but that might be freezes of a stable version of a package even. I mean, maybe the upstream is working with 2.1, and that's beta, and it's not going to be released in 6 months, okay, and Debian has 2.0. And that actually happened to me with game, okay? 1.5 versus 2.0. The beta is not going to be released for a long time, but the translation is updated there. That translation could be used to make a new update for the Debian package. That will mean that the guys using the package at that point in time, the Spanish users, will actually profit from that translator. So at that point in time, that's a maintenance issue, but we recommend that during freezes, either upstream freezes that'll take a long time, or, and most importantly, Debian freezes that might last 3 months and we cannot make a new release, please use the VDS for translations and get those translations applied and do a new version of that. Your conclusions.
So yeah, conclusion is mine. Actually, it's not exactly the conclusion. I propose you will have a small question break because I asked you to keep the question for the end. And after the questions, I will keep some time. We have a big time slot. We are lucky. So, or you are unlucky, actually, because we have a big time slot. And we will summarize this buff we meet during the DebConf. We need, you know me. We need internationalization in more areas. Why? We want more users. We want to dominate the world. We want the CDDs to be distributed everywhere. Not only Ubuntu, by the way, but also Debian Edu, for instance, or Schooly Linux. So we want these users happy. We want them to use our software. No single English word should appear in a Schooly Linux install. We need to target more languages. You've seen this nice red planet, but it still has some blank parts. You have seen it, Africa. I asked Mark Shuttleworth this morning about it because this is one of the most important parts in the developing countries. We are mostly covering Asia also, but we are missing some parts. And this is important if we want to target more audience. Jim Geddes had this talk about the one laptop per child project. On these laptops, we don't want English as language, we want the child's languages. And for all this to happen, for this all this to scale well, we need a better internationalization infrastructure. We have such good things, okay, it works currently, but it doesn't scale that well. So this is what brings us, and when I mean us, I mean most of the people in this audience, to work quite closely during this DebConf mostly, to discuss together what do we need for a good internationalization infrastructure, which I will talk just after. But before, if you have a few questions about this part of the talk, this state of the art, please go for it.
So actually, you show a picture of Africa, which is quite blank, full blank. But if I recall correctly, quite a lot of countries in Africa can speak French, or French is the official languages. And at least I think that when there's a computer, and when there's someone can use a computer, it can speak French too. Because
Least
at this point, I mean, not the child in small villages where French is not spoken at all.
So the question is mostly, as we support the colonial language, English and French, for instance, in Africa, this is a good example, after all. Do we cover Africa? There are two ways to see this. I can actually paint Africa in red.
but it would be right, actually. If we want one laptop per child, the child, this is not true. Not all child in former colonies speak English or French. Yes, currently the people who use information technology in these countries, they speak English, French, Portuguese most of the time, Spanish in some of them. But the ordinary people, they don't. So this is these people we want to target. The people who don't use computers at this moment. We don't want some big companies to give their software in these countries to localize their software. They are doing it in these languages and implement that software in these places, you know. So this is why I think, and I still think, we don't cover Africa at this moment. Yeah.
So as a package maintainer, I often receive bug reports which ask for localization, and I'm really happy to be responsive on this bug report, but I have two problems. The first one is that I sometimes don't know if the required translation is authoritative or not. Since I'm not native language in a language which can be, in the bug, I don't know if it's a correct translation or not. So the first question is if there a way to know if the bug report has been submitted by some random user or from some people of the translation group. And the second question is, sometimes it happens that I'm missing the knowledge to answer a bug report. Like it happened to me, a request to change the encoding of some Chinese translation, and the reporter added that it can be not fair with respect to traditional or whatever kind of Chinese. So do we have a place in Debian where we maintainer can pose such question? Is Debian internationalization the right place, or do we have something else?
So yeah, how to know what is authoritative for translation, what is the reference, etc. Most of the big teams have a mailing list, so that's the good point. So one of the first place to go is the list.debian.org to check whether this particular language has a dedicated mailing list. Not all of them have, because this is a request by our beloved list master not to have as many lists as we have languages, because several teams are made up by only one person. So if you want to know whether someone is authoritative for his language first, or her language most of the time, first ask to the corresponding mailing list if there is one. If there is none, you can use Debian-i18n mailing list. This should be the place not only for translators. This is not the translator's corner. The maintainers should use it, and most of the maintainers use it quite often to communicate with translators. Question by Alfie.
The map you showed before was covered with the red parts. That was the installer only. I want to point this out again, because there are very much other parts that need very much support from translators, so don't lean back and say, oh, it's covered already, it's red. There are very much other parts to translate and get into good stuff, and even there are still programs that are not internationalized now, which need to get code patches to be able to be translatable.
So this was mostly a message to maintainers by Alfie, I think. Yeah, first of all, I want to apologize for always using the installer's translation stats for this kind of demonstration. I know, of course, the installer is not everything in Debian. This is just the first thing you see when you try to install Debian. So it's kind of the entry point. We define some new processes inside the installer, new language process, and so it's kind of a model to, but of course it's not everything. Most of the time the big end users application, which is the main target, OpenOffice, Firefox, all these things, are well translated. And most of the time the new translator we have in DI come from these translation teams. So this is something that goes
both ways. So of course I know the map is not right. It's got a neat way to show what's happening. Hopefully I won't make it next year again. You'll get bored, people.
Knut Irving again from the infamous Google Linux project. Jim Getty has a point, and we have also done the same in Scholar Linux, that the program isn't really finished translated because we haven't catched up in the Norwegian branch of the translating. And we have even then translated the package even if the Debian is freezed, okay? And we have installed a updated language version of the programs even if everything is freezed. And Jim Getty's also pointed that out, that they should, because of one laptop per child project, we have these problems in a lot of parts in Africa. It's child we're talking about here. They don't speak French. They talk their native tongue. So they should use their native language, but it's not really translated, and it has to be updated on already released software. And could that be a thing? You know, I break every Debian rule here asking of this, but could that be a thing to think about to get newer translating things into Debian stable or Debian H plus 1.5 or 1.5 or something? I just ask.
So you merely suggest that we do translation updates to stable release? Yeah, I think so. Maybe Javier has an answer.
Okay, we probably have a thing there that Ubuntu does right and we don't do right, which is translations are included with the packages, cannot be updated without updating the packages themselves. What Ubuntu does right now, if anybody here can correct me if I'm wrong, is that they provide packages that include new translations that they can be targeted as stable. So that's probably one of the things we have to think about maybe doing somehow, maybe in a hackish kind of way for Edge. But we don't have a target for that and nobody's working on that. So we haven't even started thinking about that. I think one of the things the translation team want to first have covered is to have a good idea of all the things that need to be translated and be able to work on that before targeting major changes in the process of how translations are distributed, as you say. Maybe one of the things that we have to make is like KDA packages that are done, that the translations are all outside the packages of the software themselves, so we could probably get away with talking about the stable release manager to be able to make updates for Edge plus one for those packages which do not include code and just include data. But that's something that has to happen in a more global way, and without any hacks, we don't see that coming for Edge at least. So maybe that would be a target for Edge plus one or whatever. Okay, so, but that's definitely something we have to start thinking about as soon as we got covered, as you'll see on the above, a proper infrastructure to handle all the different things we have translated. Okay, but that's also something that had to be done with the release managers, and none of them are here, right?
No, because our release managers do not care about internationalization. Even one of them left yesterday. Oh, that's too bad. No, they do care about it. Bruno, please. Probably the last question. I want to go with the BOF conclusion.
Okay. It's not a secret that non-developers are very active in this area. And somehow it's the way that they get integrated in the project. So my question is, you are happy with the current permissions that they have, for example, in the SVN?
You asked me for a personal opinion, you know. Mm-hmm. So am I happy with the status of translators? I currently am, yes. I would say that three years ago, I would not have been because, well, more than three of, let's say, 4 or 5 years. But now I think that, first of all, internationalization, localization has been widely recognized in Debian, widely accepted by all developers. And I'm still waiting for someone to just come at me and say, hey, Christian, I don't care shit about your internationalization stuff. It
didn't happen. Maybe some think about it, but they don't want to be killed anyway. So so the status of translators has improved, certainly. There have been some debates about some official status for translators. I think that maybe some discussion can happen. I hope some of you have seen Christoph Berg's and Mark Brockschmidt proposal for new maintainer process and new status inside Debian. This has to be discussed. My personal opinion, maybe we can find some intermediate status. Yes, it will be complicated, and maybe we don't need that. And one last comment about Javier, please.
Just to make a point here, and that's from experience, just to make a little point. I haven't seen anybody that has has showed that can do translation and has asked for access to either CVS on the DDP, on the website, on the Debian installer, which is at Alioth and doesn't require a Debian account or the special guest accounts to work. I haven't seen anybody that has been turned down if they have shown that they can actually do translations and they can prove that. Probably France has gone away, but people are getting access to the SVN without being translator, without any problem at Alioth and the Debian website. So that's not a problem right now.
And actually, the only one person that has been removed commit access is not a translator. Kind of joke. This leads us to, yeah, Felipe, I would like to go on you.
Just one point about the updates of the stable. Maybe, I'm not sure, but maybe we can use volatile for that. They are aimed for data package, so it's as language. I can talk with the volatile team, but maybe.
That would need language packs or such things. Well, we'll see. Keep the suggestion. So I'd like to summary if someone wants to escape now, please do. Yeah, thank you, Marga. yeah, we have like 15 minutes, thank you, to summarize all this buff we had with many of you during this DebConf. So I tried to make it short so that maybe one or two questions pop up. My experience, first of all, it has been so enthusiastic, so good work we did during this DebConf. So I have a lot of things to summarize. I have so few time. I'll try to be exhaustive, but please forgive me if I forget something. We need the internationalization infrastructure. We concluded with this. And we really desperately need it if we want to scale. We want it as modular design as possible. I mean, this is a conclusion of most of the technical people in the audience who I talked with. We want it to be as modular as possible, to give as much possibilities as possible, because our targets are very, very various. So we have to be completely modular. We currently have two opportunities to advance on this project, two very soon opportunities. First of all, the Google Summer of Code proposals. There has been one proposal in the Google Summer of Code to work on the internationalization infrastructure. Discussions have already started on, as usual, the Debian i18n mailing list with the guy who proposed this, who is,
Gintautas Miloskas.
So you can actually pronounce Lithuanian name. Yeah, you. Okay, so a guy from Lithuania. Maybe he's watching us, I hope so. So sorry for breaking your name. So we are talking about this. This is a good opportunity. He will not write down the whole Debian internationalization infrastructure alone. That's absolutely not possible, but some parts can be done, and we still need to discuss it. Actually, IGAS has been proposed to be the mentor for this project. We don't know if the project will be accepted or not. We have good hope for it to be accepted. We also have what's called the Extremadura session, the sessions funded by the Junta de Extremadura in Spain. to work on some specific Debian project. I proposed one in September. We will meet over there in September for actually the September 8th to September 10th, like 20 people, no more, probably. We'll see. And either work on technical stuff, either continue to discuss, because maybe we will need to discuss again to be sure we design something well. So what we've done during the DebConf, we have mostly achieved overall specification analysis. We have identified our targets, who are the translators, of course. Our main targets are the translators. We want them the tool, or you, because most of you around are translators or work in translation teams. We want you or us to work in a good infrastructure, have better tools, and fulfill what's missing in what we said before. The reviewer, who are most of the time the translators, we want to fulfill also the needs of the team coordinators so that they can assign tasks and so on. I won't go into the details of what will be these needs, but we define many of them. Some of our targets are the maintainers. We want to improve the discussion with maintainers and translators, and the maintainers and the systems, for instance, allow the maintainers to grab the translation or to call for updates, in a way, to communicate in both ways. What we call the visitors, well, the visitors are the people who just pop up on the future Debian internationalization servers, just like some people pop up on the Rosetta server and just say, oh, it's cool, oh, yeah, it's nice colors, red, green, and my language is red, not completely translators. I want to come in, jump in. Oh, I want to do some review process. Oh, I've seen this specific strings completely wrongly translated. I want to report it. These are visitors. These are people who pop up. And the administrators of the system, of course, the people who will run this stuff, authorize the translation coordinators. So we identify all these targets, and maybe there are a few more, but I think we cover most of the needs. We know mostly all of the needs of these targets. We need probably to improve the analysis of the translator needs, because most of the discussion in the Debian i18n have focused on these needs of translators, but there have been also discussion on the side needs. Not side, I should not say side. Other needs. We need to improve analysis of the maintainer needs. Maybe this is one part we lack some input from people who are outside translation stuff. The maintainers are the people who maintain the Debian packages, but also the upstream maintainers. What do they need? How do they want to work? All this should happen from now in the Debian i18n mailing list. So I expect it to become one of the most active mailing lists in Debian without flameworks, please. In the next week, please. Also, we are 33, we will be on time. A way to go, and I think this, I really hope this will be the way to go. We finally concluded that it would be a good way to collaborate with the WordForge project. We were lucky to have Javier Sola representing the WordForge project over here. Thank you. Javier made a long trip to come over here, but to be with us and to learn with us. And our exchanges have been very, very interesting. And maybe we will continue just after. He has to leave us soon, but maybe we will have a small talk again. Yeah. Why do we want to collaborate with WordForge? Because we found that WordForge is opened, committed to promote open standards. This was most of the Javier improvised presentation, committed to XLIF, to PO as standards for translation,
committed to standards and promote standards for glossaries, translation memories, all these things that make translation work and scale. They want also promote to open protocol to communicate between internationalization infrastructure. So this could be a good way to not going against Rosetta and Launchpad stuff. We have mostly decided not to go with Rosetta tools, mostly because it's not based on free software. Most of you know about this, but we don't want to go against Ubuntu people. We had good talk, and we will have still good talk with Ubuntu people about this, and they are very open to collaborate with WorldForge. So I think that the three of us can do very neat things, and because communication would be possible in all these systems. Modularity is the key. This was coming over and over and over. We want a plugin to be able to communicate by mail with translation. We want a plugin to be able to work on the web. We want to, et cetera, et cetera. We want some client tools, client server stuff, et cetera. Our target is very wide. There are some countries where bandwidth is so costful, they can't translate on the web. Even downloading stuff is not that easy. Maybe they want web server in their countries, etc. So we want all this openness, and we found that WordForge is able to provide all this. Yeah. I'll keep this, because this is the typical conclusion of a good talk, as Mike explained, and hopefully it was a good talk, but it's open for questions about this part. I guess there will be a lot of, and if there are too much, we will just move and meet, especially with Javier, and use the last time he has in Mexico for that. Please, questions?
For us, for WordForge has been also a really rich conference. We have been working on preparing this localization infrastructure as a general thing for open source, but coming here has opened me to a lot of new things, and especially to work together with Debian on the specifications of the system that we're building, and maybe on the development also. So it's to our interest also to make sure that our specifications in our project fit what Debian needs. Because whatever Debian needs also will be what other projects in open source will need. At the end, localization infrastructure doesn't have that many specific things for different projects. But I have seen so many good ideas here in the 2 days that I've been here. And I have seen a lot of people that we would like to work with for specifying what WordForge should be.
And yes, and we are lucky to have Javier now subscribed to Debian i18n and mailing list, so we can talk with him now. Knut. No, you had no questions. Okay, you were moving, so. Oh, you're happy. Okay, so let's make. So yeah. For those who don't know about it, despite his name, Javier, he's not from Spain. He's from Spain, of course, but he lives in Cambodia. So it's quite a long trip just to come 2 days at DebConf. So thank you again, Javier.
Just out of curiosity, can you give us an overview of the Summer of Code proposal which regard internationalization and how interact with the WordPress in stuff?
Yeah, the answer will not be very precise, you know, because we are still thinking about it. Problem of this Google Summer of Code application, it comes very early for us. We are not still finished discussing and setting up our ideas. My main idea is, well, Debian has waited like 13 years for having a good internationalization infrastructure, so we are not that in a hurry. But okay, we are also in a hurry, but better well designed than badly designed. So what we are converging to, maybe Aigas would like to comment, maybe he has some ideas. We'd like to converge towards having the Google Summer of Code project work on some specific parts of what's needed. And especially we will probably work with the WordForge specifications. I sent recently the URL this morning, actually, to the mailing list. They have a very good specifications for the needs. They have very good roadmap for what they want to be achieved. So this project could be one of these bounties. We don't know which one. Probably the core some core parts, probably some design parts, because most of the Google Summer of Code applicants are people who like to code. And Gituntas, or whoever is his first name, is also very open to discuss, but he appeared to me as someone wanting to code. And this is fair, of course, so we will find something. And we've not completely decided, frankly.
Other comments?
So thank you, people, for staying awake all long time.